Hi, I'm Zor. Welcome to User Education. We continue developing the theory of definite integrals, and the first application I started with to introduce definite integrals was the area under the curve of the function. Now, so the previous lecture was purely theoretical, and let me just remind you that we have defined the concept of area under the curve. If this is the curve, this is the function f of x, this is a, this is b. We have decided to divide the segment AB into small intervals and build a rectangle which has the base, the corresponding interval, and the height some value within this particular set of values within this interval. It can be maximum, it can be minimum, it can be everything in the middle, it can be left border or right border of this interval. Doesn't really matter, because as number of these intervals goes to infinity, while the width of the largest goes to zero, the limit will exist and will be always the same, and that limit will be by definition the area under the curve. So today I would like to basically present two concrete cases of calculation, what exactly this area under curve is, if we will follow the algorithm, if we will follow the process of dividing our segment into pieces and then increasing the number of intervals. Okay, so by the way, as far as the formula is concerned, I will put this formula here. So that's f of ci times delta xi, I from 1 to n, where ci belongs to xi minus 1 xi, and delta xi is xi minus xi minus 1. So delta xi is basically the width of the i's interval. Xi is here, xi minus 1, and this is xi. So this particular interval is xi, where a is x0 and b is xn, all right? So xi is any point within this particular interval. It can be left, right, maximum, minimum, middle point, whatever it is. Doesn't really matter. We have proven in the previous lecture that the limit of this expression, as long as delta xi are going to zero, well, the largest among them goes to zero, the limit will exist, and that would be the area under the curve. And the examples which we will consider are two actual examples. So let me start with the first one. So the first example is function is 10x on interval from 0 to 4. Okay, so it looks like this. This is 4, this is 10x, which means this is 40, right? This is 0. Now this is area under the curve. So this is our function. This is interval from 0 to 4, the segment. Now, obviously, from geometry, we know that if this is 4 and this is 40, then the area of this triangle, which is actually an area under the curve, would be 4 times 40 divided by 2, which is 80. So let's just keep in mind this, and this is obviously the right way of doing this, except that that's not the one which I would like to introduce you to. I would like to use this formula and come up with the same number if possible. I hope I will be able to. Okay, so let's just remember this result, and what we will do is we will do exactly what our process is telling us. So we will divide into n pieces. Well, let's divide first into two pieces. So this is x0, this is x2, and the middle one is x1. So this is one interval, this is another interval. So we will build two intervals on our segment. Now, let's take, let's say, a left point on each interval. So the left point here is 0, so the rectangle will have 0 height. And so it will be 0 times the length of the interval is 2, right? And this is the rectangle, so that's basically equal to 0. The second rectangle would be here, and as I said, I'm adjusting by the left boundary. So if this is 2, this is 20. So the height of this rectangle is 20. So it will be 2 times 20 is equal to 40. And the total will be 40. So sum of this rectangle, which has 0 height, and this rectangle would be 40. Well, it's obviously less than the area which we are talking about. Okay, now let's do it more finely divided segment. Let's divide it into 4 pieces. So this is 1, this is 2, this is 3. So this would be x1, x2, and this is x3. And this is x4. So we have 4 different intervals. And let's do exactly the same. Build a rectangle based on each interval with the left value as the height. So again, the first will be 0. The second would be 10, obviously, and this is 30. So the first will be 0, the second would be 10 times 2, next it would be 20 times 2, and next would be 30 times 2 equals 2, 10, 20, 30, 20, no, sorry, not by 2, by 1. I see something is wrong. 2 was the previous, now I have only 1. The width of each interval is 1. So that's, 60. So it was 40 first, my next is 60. Should we continue? Well, let's just go through one more iteration. So we have divisions by 1/2. This is 1 1/2. This is 2 1/2. This is 3 1/2. Now, so this height would be 5. Now this would be 15. This would be 25, and this would be 35. So what we have is 0 times half, which is 0, then 5 times half, 2.5, ten times half is 5, 15 is 7.5, 20 times half is 10, 25, 12.5, 30, 15, and 35 is 17.5, right? That's my last rectangle. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Right, 8 rectangles. This is the 2 rectangles, this is 4 rectangles, and this is 8 rectangles. So what is the sum? This and this is 20, and another 20 is 40, and another is 60, and 10, 70. So you see, our first iteration was 40, then 60, then 70, and you remember the whole area is equal to 80 from the geometry, right? So it looks like we are actually moving to the right direction. Okay, so now it's time to do it precisely. So let's consider that we have divided this into n pieces, n equal pieces, right? So my xi's is equal to what? So we divide 4 into n pieces, which means my xi would be equal to I times 4 divided by n, right? So the length from 0 to xi, this is coordinates, right? So xi minus xi minus 1 is 4 divided by n. So that's my delta x, y. Now, f of xi is equal to this times 10, right? Function is 10 times x. So this would be 40i divided by n. So now I have to summarize function value, 40 times I divided by n times 4 divided by n from I from 1 to n, right? So this is my height of the rectangle, this is my width of the rectangle. So it's equal to 160 divided by n square I from 1 to n. Well, we all know what is the sum of i's. It's 1 plus 2 plus 3, etc. plus n. Very easy to count. I do remember that the formula is this. N times n plus 1 divided by 2 equals 280 n plus 1 divided by n, right? And what's the limit as n goes to infinity? Well, this is obviously goes to 1, so the limit is 80. And that's exactly what we had to really obtain, if you remember, right? From geometrical considerations. So it looks like it works fine. So this particular process, and now I have divided into n equal parts. Basically, it's not really necessary, because as I was saying in the previous lecture, the theorem was proven that it doesn't really matter how I divide into n pieces, as long as with n increasing to infinity, my largest segment goes to zero. So it doesn't really matter. I chose the easiest way, right? When all intervals are equal to each other. Now then, the height of the rectangles, I have chosen by left boundary. I could have chosen by the right boundary, it will probably be exactly the same. Should I demonstrate it? Well, it's very easy actually, I think. Because then, I think in this case it would be I plus 1, and it would not really change the limit. Okay, I'm not going to do it, but basically it's kind of obvious. Okay, next example. So the first one, we have proven that we are going to the right number using this particular process. Now let's consider slightly more complicated example, because now I will have, as a function, I will have y equals to 1 minus x square on interval from minus 1 to 1. Now, x squared is, as you know, parabola, minus x squared would be inverted parabola, and plus 1, I have to raise it by 1 above the x-axis, right? So it would be something like this, from minus 1 to 1. At x is equal to minus 1 or 1, y is equal to 0, right? So this is basically my segment, and this is the area which I would like to basically calculate the area of. Alright, just to make things a little bit simpler, let me, instead of considering from minus 1 to 1, let's consider only from 0 to 1, and then I will double the result, because the parabola is symmetrical. There is absolutely nothing wrong with going all the way from minus 1 to 1, and in the description of this lecture, in the notes on theunizor.com, I do consider from minus 1 to 1. It's just a little bit easier for me to do it here from 0 to 1. So let me just do it from 0 to 1, so I don't really have to worry about negative numbers and stuff like this. So let's consider this. Only this part. Okay. So again, let's do exactly the same thing. We will divide this particular area into n equal parts. So my xi is equal to 1 over n, right? So this is 1, and divided by n parts. So that's my xi. Now x, I'm sorry, it's I divided by n. It's delta xi, which is equal to xi minus I, which is 1 over n. Okay, now my f of xi, so let's talk about the left boundary of each, or right boundary, whatever, at xi, this definitely belongs to interval, ith interval, right? It's equal to 1 minus xi squared, right? Which is 1 minus I squared divided by n squared. Now, if I sum f of xi times delta xi, what I will get? I will get 1 minus I squared divided by n squared times 1n equals 2 sigma 1n minus sigma I squared divided by n cubed, right? If I open these parentheses, it will be 1n and minus I squared divided by n squared times n, which is n cubed. Now this is from 1 to n, so this is equal to n times 1n, which is 1. 1 minus sigma I squared divided by n cubed. Okay, so it's 1 minus 1 over n cube, it's a constant so far, of I square of 1 to n equals 2. Now I happen to remember, well, not remember, I wrote it down, the formula for sum of the I square. I mean, you can prove it by induction, or there are different ways to do it. Let's not waste our time. I'll just use it as it is. N cube. So sum of I square is equal to n times n plus 1 times 2n plus 1 divided by 6, which is equal to, well, obviously, if you will factor out 2, you will have n plus something, and again n plus something. Well, in this case it's n plus 1 half. And this is n cube. So 1 minus 2 over 6, and here I will have n cube, n times n plus 1 times n plus 1 half. Correct? And obviously this thing goes to 1 as n goes to infinity, because this is polynomial, this is n cube, this is n cube. So if you divide n cube by n cube is 1, and everything else would be n square and n, etc., which dividing by n cube will give you n in the denominator, and it will go to 0. So the whole thing is equal 1 minus 2 sixths, or 1 minus 1 third, which is 2 thirds. And the whole area, if you will add this half, it will be 4/3. So that's basically the answer to this problem. Again, if you do not remember this formula, just try to prove it by induction if you want to. It's very, very easy to prove that the sum of squares from 1 to n is equal to this. By induction, it just really in no time at all. So these are two examples of how to approach the area under curve using the classical definition of what actual area is. Now, do people do exactly what I have just done? Absolutely not. They are calculating the area under the curve in a completely different way. And to demonstrate you how exactly it can be done, which I will do in the next lecture, that's exactly how I will introduce the definite integral. So the definite integral is actually an answer how to easier calculate something like area under the curve using our apparatus, which we have already known, which is derivative and indefinite integral, which is sometimes called antiderivative because it's a reverse operation. But that would be the subject of the next lecture. Meanwhile, what I might actually suggest you as an exercise, if you really are up to this, I have just used the value on the, I think on the right side of the interval of xi, right? Try to use it on the left interval, on the left side, function of xi minus 1. And see if you will get exactly the same result. It's a very nice little exercise, and you will also have some kind of summation problem. Would be really interesting to see if you will get the same. I mean, you must get the same, because I have proven the theorem in the previous lecture that you have the same thing. But it's just always nice to basically make sure that everything is gold. All right, so that's it for today. Thank you very much and good luck.